Hello students, welcome to our session on economics this week, wherein we'll be taking up some of the very important articles which have appeared in various business related newspapers, and we'll be analyzing these particular articles. For this particular video, I've chosen the time period from 12th of August to 18th of August 2019, and the articles that I've chosen are from Businessline, Hindu, Business Standard, Indian Express, Live Mint. Let's begin the discussion. The first article is related to 15th Finance Commission and the issue of devolution to the states. Now, some of the important basic points are: Finance Commission is set up once every 5 years. Presently, the recommendation of 14th Finance Commission are in the progress of being implemented, and the time period is from 2015 to 2020. So the next Finance Commission has already been set up, and this particular Finance Commission is expected to give the report by the end of November 2019. And the recommendations of this particular commission will be applicable for a 5-year time period from 2020 to 2025. Out of all the recommendations which are given by the Finance Commission, the most important recommendation is related to devolution to the states. Now, what do you mean by the term devolution? Central government will impose and collect taxes. This particular right of imposing and collection of taxes is given to the central government under the Constitution of India. And since this particular right has been given, it imposes a large number of taxes and collects these particular taxes. But more importantly is this particular fact. Majority of these particular taxes are put into an account or a fund which is called as divisible pool. Some of the books will mention the term central divisible pool. Both are one and the same. But also understand this: all the taxes which are collected by the central government are not put in this particular central divisible pool. Some of the taxes, such as surcharges, cesses, etc., are not kept or not submitted into the central divisible pool. Now, whatever taxes are pooled into this particular fund, these particular taxes first will be distributed between center and the states, and whatever share is given to all the states again will have to be distributed amongst the states. I'll repeat the statement. From the central divisible pool or the divisible pool of taxes, first the division will happen between the center as well as the states. Then whatever share has been allocated to the states, it has to be distributed amongst all these particular states. This particular process is called as devolution of taxes. And whenever these particular taxes are distributed between center and the states, this is called as vertical devolution. And when these are distributed amongst the states, it is called as horizontal devolution. Now, what has been the progress in case of the devolution in the recent past? The 11th Finance Commission basically recommended a devolution formula of 29.5%. What is the meaning of this? If the central divisible pool has got 100 rupees, 29.5 will go to states and remaining will go to center. The 12th Finance Commission increased this to 30.5%. The 13th Finance Commission increased this to 32%, and the 14th Finance Commission, whose recommendations are being implemented, increased this particular devolution by a huge margin to 42%. That is, in simple terms, as per the recommendations of a 14th Finance Commission, out of 100 rupees which are present in the divisible pool of taxes, 42 rupees will go to states collectively, and remaining 58 rupees will go to center. And this particular 42 rupees will be again distributed amongst the states. This is the basic concept of the Finance Commission in the recent past. Now, what is the issue of discussion here? In case of the Indian government or the central government, in the recent times, it has come under a lot of financial pressure. For example, implementation of GST has led to certain under-recoveries in terms of tax collections for the central government. And upon this, the government of India has incurred a huge amount of a capital expenditure. In simple terms, what they are trying to tell you is this: when the financials of the central government are under pressure, if the 15th Finance Commission increases the devolution to more than 42%, then it will further put the pressure on the central government's finances. I'll repeat the statement again. As per the recommendation of 14th Finance Commission, the devolution to the states will be how much? 42%. Now the concern is, if the 15th Finance Commission increases this devolution to more than 42%, then it will put a larger pressure in terms of the financials for the central government. So the gist of the article says that, keeping in mind that the central government does not have very high fiscal space, it is more worried about fiscal deficit, it is incurring huge amount of a capital expenditure, and apart from this, central government also transfers large amount of revenues for the state government in the form of disaster grants, in the form of the centrally sponsored schemes, so on and so forth. So if the central government takes into consideration all these transfers, apart from this particular 42% transfers, which is mandated by the 14th Finance Commission, the total transfer from the divisible pool of taxes will cross more than 50%. So this is being discussed in this particular article. Now, apart from this, another very important point which has been mentioned in this particular article is this. Central government will incur certain form of a capital expenditure. For example, development of defense infrastructure. Now, what has been mentioned in this article is this. The 15th Finance Commission has been asked to look into this particular possibility wherein the capital expenditure which is incurred by the government, let's say in the form of defense infrastructure development, might be taken out of this particular divisible pool of taxes. What is the meaning of this? Let's say hypothetically, there are 100 crore rupees in the divisible pool of taxes and the central government incurs 10 crores in the form of development of defense infrastructure. Then the divisible pool of taxes, which will be distributed between center and state, shall be reduced to 90 crore rupees. In simple terms, some of the forms of capital expenditure which are incurred by the central government will be taken out of this particular divisible pool of taxes. And if that is the recommendation given by the 15th Finance Commission, then a new devolution formula will also be given. Because earlier what used to happen? Whatever are the taxes collected by the central government will be put in the divisible pool of taxes. Then they'll be distributed between central and state and amongst the states. But now 15th Finance Commission may basically recommend a new formula wherein certain form of a capital expenditure incurred by the central government will be withdrawn from the divisible pool of taxes. Then whatever is left out will be distributed between the center and state, then amongst the states. In simple terms, a new devolution formula could be given by the 15th Finance Commission. And if this is done, the devolution that will go to the states might come down. This is the precise reason why some of the states are opposed to this particular proposal of the central government. So this is the gist of the article. Now based on this, let's have a look at a question. Consider the following statements about Finance Commission. The distribution of all the direct and indirect taxes collected is done as per the recommendations of the Finance Commission. No, this is wrong. I've already mentioned this particular point. Yes, central government will impose and collect the taxes, but not all the taxes are part of the divisible pool. Surcharge and cess are left out of the divisible pool of taxes. And apart from this, the GST, which is the indirect tax or the most important indirect tax in India now, whenever it is collected, 50% of this particular GST collection will go to the states and 50% will go to the center. And whatever is collected by the center, that is in the form of CGST, central GST, will form the part of divisible pool of taxes. So, first statement is wrong. Finance Commission is a constitutional body. Yes, it is set up under Article 280. So, second statement is correct. Right option will be option B. Only second statement is true. Let's look at the next article. It is related to differential voting rights. Before looking at what is given in the article, what is the concept of a differential voting right? Very recently, SEBI has put in the guidelines or has proposed the guidelines as per which the DVRs will be issued by the companies. And the government very recently has proposed to amend the Companies Act, wherein even the startups will be allowed to issue the differential voting rights. Now, what do you mean by differential voting rights here? Let's say hypothetically, there is a company X which has issued 100 shares. And if I own one share out of this, in simple terms, I'm 1% stakeholder or the owner of the company. And whenever any decision has to be taken in, let's say, during the annual general meeting, I will be given the right to vote during this particular discussion. And how many votes can I put? As many shares I hold, I will be allowed to vote as many times. Here in this example, I'm owning one share, I will have to vote once. But there are certain issues with respect to this, especially from the purview of the startups. What is the issue here? Issue is, if a particular company, let's say Z, has issued 100 shares and a particular person buys 10 shares at this point of a time and goes to the market, that is the stock market, and purchases another 41 shares from the market, then basically this particular person will be owning 51% of this particular company Z. This is basically a concept of a hostile takeover. That is, as a owner, I do not know who is trading my shares in the market. But suddenly one fine day, this particular investor comes to my office and says, since he owns 51% of the shares of the company, he is the majority owner of the company. This is the basic concept of an hostile takeover. And this will happen whenever single share is given one voting right. So to prevent this kind of an issue, government has proposed the concept of a differential voting right, wherein having one share will not give you a right to vote. Rather, you will have to hold specific number of shares. Only then you will be allowed to vote once. I'll repeat the statement. Having one share will not give you the right to vote. You will have to hold a specific number of shares. Only then you will be allowed to vote once. For example, there's a company by the name Gujarat NRE Coke. This particular company has issued the differential voting right shares. And if you have purchased the DVRs which are issued by this particular company, when you purchase 100 shares, that is 100 DVR shares, then you will have the right to vote once. Have you understand this? When you purchase 100 units of these particular DVR shares which are issued by this particular company, you will be allowed to vote once. So basically, this particular concept of a DVR will help the owner of the company to issue the shares in the market, and the dilution of ownership will be very less. Have you understand this? I'll repeat the statement. The owner can issue the shares in the market. These are the DVR shares. The dilution of ownership will be very less. And the second point is, the threat of hostile takeover will be reduced with the issue of these particular differential voting right shares. Now, what is the context of this particular article? In case of the startups, one of the very important constraint for them is access to finance. These particular startup companies need huge amount of financing requirement. And many a times when they approach the investors, such as venture capitalists, such as qualified institutional buyers, qualified institutional placement, whenever it is thought to be done, the issue is these particular investors demand ownership stake in these particular companies. Hence, they fear that they might end up losing the ownership of their own company. Now, what Government of India says is, even these particular startups can issue the shares with the differential voting rights, wherein number of shares which are issued will be very high. The startup can generate lot of money by selling these particular shares in the market. But most importantly, the ownership dilution will be very, very less. In simple terms, the ownership still will be concentrated in the hands of the original owners or the entrepreneurs themselves. This is the context of this particular article. For example, this particular company which wants to issue these particular shares with the differential voting rights was supposed to have distributable profits for a period of at least 3 years and should have filed the returns for last 3 years. Only under these particular conditions, this particular company was allowed to issue shares with differential voting rights. But now Government of India has done away with this particular requirement, which will basically promote the companies to issue the DVRs in the market and generate money which is used for the business purposes. So this is the gist of the article given here. Based on this, let's have a look at the question. Consider the following statements about differential voting rights. These are not allowed to be traded in the market. Wrong. Please understand, company X will issue shares with the differential voting rights. If I purchase these particular shares, I will be allowed to trade them in the secondary market, that is in the stock market. What do you mean by trade? I will be allowed to sell or purchase these particular shares with the differential voting rights. But more importantly, understand this. Since there is a limitation of voting related to these particular DVRs, usually these particular DVRs are traded at a discount in the market. Let's say hypothetically, I'm a trader in the stock market. I've got an option to purchase a share of a company, which is a normal share. And there's also a share with differential voting right. Now, if I purchase this particular share, I will be having a right to vote. Whereas this particular share with the DVR doesn't guarantee me or doesn't give me the right to vote right away. I will have to purchase a minimum number of shares. Only then I will be allowed to vote once. So in this particular situation, I will demand this particular share with the DVR at a discount, at lower prices. Hence, remember this, these particular shares with DVRs are allowed to be traded in the market, and usually these are traded at discount prices. First statement is wrong. Second statement, investors owning DVRs are not allowed to vote. Wrong. If you want to vote, you will have to have a specific number of shares. I've already given an example of Gujarat NRE Coke, in which case you will have to purchase 100 shares and you will be given right to vote. That is, you own 100 shares, you can vote once. So basically, second statement is also wrong. Based on this, right option will be option D. Both the statements are false. Let's look at the next article, which is related to renewable energy. Government of India has set up a target of installing 175 gigawatts of renewable energy capacity by 2022. Out of this, 100 gigawatts has been allocated for solar, 60 gigawatts has been allocated for wind energy, and remaining 15 gigawatts has been allocated between biomass plus hydro. But more importantly, what is the issue discussed in this particular article? This article discusses whether the Government of India has implemented right measures so as to leverage certain advantages which are available for Government of India in this particular renewable energy sector. Now, what is the advantage that they're speaking of? In case of the renewable energy, please understand this. Initially, to generate 1 kilowatt hour of solar energy in case of India, in the year 2010, the cost incurred was around 17 rupees. In simple terms, when these were sold, or this unit was sold to a buyer in the market, the cost was 17 rupees. And over a period of time, it has kept on declining. And presently, the solar as well as the wind energy prices, that is in terms of kilowatt hour, are hovering between 2 rupees to 3 rupees. And these particular prices are somewhat similar to the prices of the energy which has been generated from fossil fuels. For example, NTPC, National Thermal Power Corporation, which is one of the biggest generator of thermal energy in case of India, sells thermal energy at 3 rupee 20 paisa per kilowatt hour. So the prices are somewhat similar. But the question is, has Government of India leveraged this particular opportunity? This article discusses that Government of India has not leveraged. What are the facts given in this particular article, which basically showcase that Government of India has not implemented the right measures? To prove this, They have compared what has been the installation of renewable energy in case of India with China. And this comparison is important for a simple reason. China is one of the giants or the leaders in terms of addition of renewable energy capacity in the last decade. The time period that has been taken is between 2014 to 2017. And the fact which has been quoted in this particular article are this. Between these 3 years, the government of China has added renewable energy capacity of somewhere 207 gigawatts. Compared to this, India just has added over 33 gigawatts. That is approximately 1/6 of the renewable energy capacity added by the Chinese government. Second, within this 207 gigawatts, the amount of capacity addition from the solar energy sector is more than 105 gigawatts. Compared to this, in case of India, the capacity addition is just around 14 gigawatts. And third fact, even countries such as USA and Japan have added twice the capacity under the solar energy which has been added by the government of India. So basically, these facts showcase that though the advantage is available, the reforms which have been implemented are not right. Now, what reforms am I speaking of? Or what steps taken by the government am I referring to here? One, the government of India very recently has announced safeguard duties on SPVs, solar photovoltaic cells. India imports more than 80% of its cells or SPVs from the foreign market, especially from China. And very recently, government of India has imposed safeguard tariffs or safeguard duties on the SPV imports which are coming from China. This, along with the exchange rate volatility, has basically made the imports costlier. And when these particular imports become costlier, the cost of project will also increase, which will basically have a negative impact on the revenues of these particular developers. Second, the government on one side has implemented safeguard duties, but we do not have the domestic manufacturers which can meet the specific requirements of the developers in the market. As a result of this only, though the safeguard duties have been imposed, the solar plant developers have continued to import these particular modules from the foreign market. Third, on one side, government of India says it wants to have installed capacity of 175 gigawatts of renewable energy by 2022. But on the other side, what has been the policy in terms of fossil fuels is negating this particular promotion. Now, what do you mean by this? The imports of coal have increased. And not just this, the consumption of coal or the demand for coal has increased by 9% in the year ending 2019. In simple terms, from 2018 to 2019, the consumption of a coal has increased by 9%. Import of coal has increased. And on the other side, government of India wants to promote the renewable energy sector. But the steps which have been taken by the government are hindering the development of renewable energy sector. Now, what is the issue with consumption of coal? Coal is the most dirtiest fuel. The emissions are very, very high. And when India is dependent on the imports of the coal, it will have a negative impact on the forex reserves which are supposed to be maintained. These are some of the points which are discussed in this particular article. The next article is related to ARCs and banks. ARCs basically stand for asset reconstruction companies. Now, what is the concept here? Let's say hypothetically, Bank B has given loan to a company X, and this particular company is supposed to repay the loan. This particular company has defaulted on the repayment. Now, I'll call this as an account. Bank B would simply want to dispose of this particular asset or account. One of the ways of disposing of this particular account is approach the ARC. Asset Reconstruction Company is a financial institution or one of the types of financial institution. What is the role of ARC? ARC takes this particular company, sells this particular company in the market, and whatever money is recovered, it will charge certain commission and the money will be given back to the bank like this. This is the basic concept or how the ARCs will function in the market. The exact process is slightly different. You do not have to worry about the process. Now, what is the issue of contention here? Whenever the ARC purchases this particular asset from the bank or the company from the bank, it makes a certain payment to the bank. Usually, this particular payment is based on the agreed value. What do you mean by agreed value? Let's say hypothetically, Bank B has to recover a debt of 100 crore rupees from this particular company X. In simple terms, X has to pay back 100 crores to Bank B. Since it has defaulted, it will not be able to pay this. So Bank B will come to an agreement with the ARC that ARC will recover, let's say, 40 crore rupees by selling this particular company in the market. Now, usually this particular 40 crore is the agreed value. And based on this agreed value, 15% will be paid upfront by the ARC to the bank. I'll repeat the statement. Based on the agreed value, ARC will pay 15% of this value to the bank in the form of upfront payment. Earlier it was 5%, but last year this has been increased to 15%. Now the ARC, apart from giving upfront payment of 15%, will also issue something called as security receipt. These particular security receipts will be monetized after the company is sold by the ARC in the market. In simple terms, 15% is in the form of a cash and remaining amount will be given in the form of a security receipt, which is nothing but a security. Now, once the ARC sells this particular asset in the market, gets the money, it will take back the security receipt and give the money to the bank. For having conducted all these particular operations, ARCs will also charge certain commission on these kind of transactions. Now, what is being discussed in this particular article? Banks are having huge amount of NPAs, non-performing assets. They want to dispose of these particular NPAs. But banks are not focused on all of these particular NPAs. These are only focused on smaller accounts. That is a smaller corporate accounts where the debt is up to 1000 crore rupees. And these ARCs are saying, we will take these particular NPAs from the banks, sell it in the market, and we will make the recovery or we'll give the recovery to the bank. But the banks are saying, rather than issuing the security receipt for us, make all the payment in the form of cash. That is, give me the money right now rather than making me wait for a certain period of time. Now, what is the issue here? The banks, which have huge amount of NPAs, their money is stuck up in this particular NPAs. So the banks wants to dispose of these particular NPAs and recover the money. But on the other side, ARCs are saying, we do not have sufficient cash or the capital that is available with us is not sufficient to make upfront payment all in the form of a cash. That is a precise reason both of these particular financial institutions are not agreeing on the concept of a recovery through the ARC route. Now, what is the contention of the bank here? Banks are saying the ARC will take the asset from me and will sell it in the market. But before it sells in the market, it has to get certain clearances from the judiciary. And this particular judicial process will take very long period of time. And the delay because of this particular process will put financial pressure on me, that is bank. These are the points which are mentioned in this particular article. The next article is related to one of the very important scheme which was mentioned recently in the newspaper, Samarth Scheme. Out of the 18 states which were identified by the Ministry of Textiles, 16 states have entered into MOU with the government. Now, what is this particular concept of a Samarth Scheme? This is a scheme which has been proposed to provide skilling to 10 lakh youth with the necessary skill sets in the textile sector. And this particular scheme will be implemented for a period of 3 years from 2017 to 2020. And the allocation that has been done is 1,300 crore rupees. Under this, certain institutions will be identified by the state governments. These institutions will be providing skilling as well as upskilling facilities to 10 lakh youth. Out of this particular 10 lakh youth, 9 lakh youth will be from the organized sector and remaining 1 lakh will be from traditional sector. Apart from this, another very important point is this is also referred to as a scheme for capacity building in textile sector, ESSC BTS. These are some of the very important points associated with this particular scheme. Based on this, let's have a straightforward question. DASH scheme has been launched by the government to skill the labor in the textile sector. The right scheme is Samarth, that is option D. So these are some of the very important articles as well as the questions for this particular time period. Thank you. Have a good day.